I'm Stefan Yost, the Michael and Sonia Kerner Director and CEO, thank you, of the Art Gallery of Ontario. We know that the AGO was transformed several years ago, and we know that Frank Gehry was behind that, and there was an extraordinary team of people who made it work. In addition to Gehry's vision, the family of Ken Thompson, and many, many, many other civic leaders who are also here today who made Transformation AGO really work. So thank you very much. One of the most important architects of our time, Frank Gehry, has transformed contemporary architecture in his innovative use of material, design, and form. His accomplishments are way too long to list, but perhaps I can mention that the US President Barack Obama honored him last week with the Presidential Medal of Freedom at the White House. On a personal note, I just want to say I think you're one of the most amazing, wonderful people, thinker, conversationalists, and welcome home. In conversation today with Frank Gehry, we have two formidable thinkers. We have Lisa Rochon and Paul Goldberger. Lisa is a champion of livable cities and poetic aspirational design. As the Globe and Mail's architectural critic and City Space national columnist from 2000 to 2013, she charted the design triumphs and failures of schools, homeless shelters, high-profile galleries, and museums, as well as skyscrapers, but a great thinker. Paul Goldberger. Okay. Paul Goldberger is contributing editor to Vanity Fair, spent 15 years as architectural critic for The New Yorker, began writing for his career as writing for The New York Times, and has been awarded for the Pulitzer Prize for distinguished criticisms for his writing on architecture. He's author of many, many books, including Why Architecture Matters, Building Up and Tearing Down, Reflections on the Age of Architecture, and Up from Zero. Paul's biography of Frank Gehry, Building Art, the Life and Work of Frank Gehry, is what brings us here today. And Paul has graciously offered to sign copies after the talk right in the back. So thank you for that. Now please welcome me in joining all three of them on stage.
Good afternoon. Such a pleasure to be here. And I just wanted to welcome Frank again back to the AGO and Paul Goldberger.
Thank you, Lisa.
It's really great to be on stage all together.
Can I say something about...
No, you can't talk.
I can't talk. So I loved working on the AGO. And I had some special partnerships with Ken Thompson, who... was an incredible delight to work with, and his collection is amazing. And when he passed on, his son David, I prevailed upon him to help install the Canadian collection. And one of my favorite rooms is Lauren Harris installation of any collection of paintings I've ever seen in my life. It's just brilliant. Where's David? He's not here, but tell him I said this.
Right.
Good. Thank you, Frank. Frank, I just wanted to open just by, you know, do a little quick thought piece. For many decades, you were considered the bad boy of architecture, and you described yourself in my book, Up North, as an outsider within the profession, even within your own family. But in the end, you've given the world architecture that really frees our minds from the orthodoxies of the city. And your curved volumes, your capture of light is freeing, and really has helped to liberate our souls. This kind of creativity, this experimentation with materials and shapes, is really a rare gesture.
But it's sort of, I didn't realize it was happening. I was the outsider, and then all of a sudden I was the insider, and I don't know.
Yeah, and it took many decades.
Where was the line? When did it happen?
Actually, it's sort of interesting.
I'm just getting sort of comfortable being the outsider.
You like being the outsider.
Well, it was comfortable.
Do you ever want to be too much the insider?
No.
I was thinking of a song I know all of us are familiar with, written by Leonard Cohen, in which he writes, "They sentenced me to 20 years of boredom for trying to change the system from within. I'm coming now. I'm coming to reward them. First we take Manhattan, then we take Berlin." Mm-hmm. Frank, can you talk to us a little bit about...
There's Frank taking Manhattan in front of you right now, in fact.
How do you wake up every day and still find the creative fire?
I don't know what else to do. Mm-hmm. You know, I swim.
You sail.
I sail. I meet with my family occasionally when they'll have me. I have a lot of good colleagues in the office that I enjoy working with. And so I'm drawn to the office. You know, I'll get up in the morning and go there.
Right.
Even on a Sunday when I know they're not there.
Yes, but I think you'd be there today if we weren't here, right?
I look around and say, what happened? Where's everybody? Anyway, I don't know, I think it's a disease. Let's some kind of emotional necessity that you become used to.
Because obviously you just as we were walking up here, you reminded me, and you've often said this to me, that you're an optimist, right? And yet you are working, this is not art that you hang on your wall or exhibit in the privacy of your own home. You're working within the constraints of the profession.
Right.
And you're dealing with a lot of political pressure, tough requirements from your clients. You're jetting around the world still. I think you're no longer 29. I think you're 87. And it takes a tremendous amount of energy.
I've been noticing the difference, actually. Well, I like the feeling. It's kind of a precarious feeling that I'm not sure what I'm going to do next. But I have some ethical construct that ensures that if I take on a project with a client, I'm going to deliver what they hope for, and that I'm going to meet their budget and their time schedule and all that kind of thing, and that it won't leak, and that it'll serve what they want. And it's taken a long time to get the team behind me but in the last 15 years or so, we've been pretty good at doing all that, creating the delivery system. And I'm never sure. I like the unknown, the exploring. And if I know in advance of something, I look at it, but done that, been there. So it's much more exciting looking for somewhere else. And what pushes it somewhere else is not just Frank Gehry's ego, it's a relationship to the community, the client, their budget and all. So the building you've just seen is Bernard Arnault. He's a terrific businessman. He's plays concert piano, he's very well educated, and he had a vision of what he wanted, and he was a wild, and he didn't talk a lot, He doesn't sit down and say, okay, Frank, I want this, 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 and this. He didn't say those things. He looked at our maquettes and models in response to his site and stuff, and commented, and so it was an evolution. But he was pretty direct, and he ended up getting the building that he wanted, so that it's not a building I would have done for anybody else, right?
Well, I think, Frank, I would say most of your buildings are not buildings you would have done anybody else.
Maya
here
Hoffman.
We're looking at Maya Hoffman's building for Arles in the south of France, which is now going up,
right?
And which is very, very different. It seems to me part of what you're saying, and this is a theme we talked about a lot in this biography, in this book, is that you're an architect. You're not a sculptor. And my sense from knowing you over these years is that the thing that really drives you crazy is not if people don't like your work. If they think it's ugly, that's their business. But when they say, oh, it's just sculpture, or it's just expensive, self-indulgent stuff that has no connection to the real world of architecture,
right,
that seems to drive you over the edge.
That's when I become Donald Trump, yes.
Right. Gee, let's see, it took us 9.5 minutes to get to that point in this conversation. I was wondering how long we'd hold out.
When you first met Mark Zuckerberg and he was wanting to create a new campus for Facebook, he had a certain degree of skepticism, right? And you had to enter into this relationship, and he signed you up for Facebook, I think, as well.
Yeah. Yes,
he did.
In fact, there it is. There is Facebook. Good timing.
He kept signing, so we're doing more.
But he wanted a plain, simple, vanilla building, right? He said, why does somebody like you want me?
Mark Zuckerberg is clearly on a path, and he has an understanding of that path, and he's focused. And so architecture is not part of his path.
Right.
And I don't think he's an art collector. He doesn't seem to be interested in things like that. He's very focused on his work and his world, and now on his philanthropies. So he's a really neat guy. He came to my office and saw my office, and my office is about a little under an acre in open space. It's about this high as this room. And he said, this is what I like, and I need a room 10 times this size, and I need it by Tuesday. And so that's what we did. And we, in a year and a half from the, I think 3 years from the moment I met him, he was using the building. So that's pretty quick.
Yep.
And then the second building, he asked if we could do it faster. I don't see him much. I see his people. Every once in a while I run into him and he says, I hope you're still happy. So he's worried about that a little bit.
But it's a very simple concept into which you brought a lot of, I think, extraordinary variation. I mean, yes, it's this huge, jillion square foot room or whatever it is.
It's not but the kind of room you would call capital A architecture.
Right.
It's not about that.
There's a lot of conceptual ideas. You know, you park, there's a layer of parking underneath.
Right.
There's a layer of garden and public space and park on the roof.
On top, yeah.
And the space itself varies a lot, I have to confess, I worried that it would look a little bit like a convention center. When it was done, it doesn't look at all like that. It's a very civilized, comfortable space to be in.
So
you did bring a lot of Frank Gehry into this.
Yeah, but at this time they wanted as many workstations and just as many in the room as possible like this. And then once this was built, they realized that they had to revise their thinking and create neighborhoods, because people were strolling through and there was no privacy and so on. So the second building is a little more organized, but it's based on a critique of this. So that's been the relationship. And then the third building is way different because security issues came to the fore.
That's the roof now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So all the two buildings are over parking, and then when life threats have come his way, you start to worry about bombs being coming in cars, so that we've eliminated the parking under and gone back to a more conventional thing. I'm trying to get some Israelis to run the parking lot. So
I wonder if we can switch from California to North.
Okay.
I think many of you know that Frank was born in Toronto in 1929, raised here during the Depression. Very, very powerful, strong memories of being raised here in Toronto. And we'll touch back on those, I think, during the course of this conversation. But if we then project further north to Timmins, you spent, I think, 5 years in Timmins. You spent summers at New Liskeard, swimming in Lake Temiscaming.
And, well, you've done your homework.
You know this. Yeah. You know this stuff. But I wanted to speak about wood and your connection to wood. I think it goes pretty deep. And I know, Paul, in your book, you chart Frank's celebration of wood from the his design of the Serpentine Gallery in London to the Fondation Louis Vuitton in Paris, even to your own new home in Santa Monica.
Which is now right on the screen.
That my son designed. I didn't do it.
So Sam designed this. He was the chief architect on this.
Well, no, I think Lisa's getting on something important. I want to get back to and make sure we don't lose it. Since you mentioned your son Sam, I want to ask you: were you a good client of his?
I think so. Megan, was I a good client? Megan,
were you a?
Turning around?
Right, right. Okay.
I thought your wife was the client.
Yeah. Right. Right. Right.
Bertha. But you can see there, like, the heavy timbers, the use of wood, and I think also...
Well, I can address that. So I grew up, I spent 5 years in Timmins, and certainly you're in the bush country. My house was right at the edge of the bush, and there's a lot of wood, a lot of trees, a lot of stuff, a lot of logging happening on the river there. A lot of the people that were at the mine were from Finland, working there on the skis, the wooden skis, the black skis, the cross-country skis. So that aesthetic was interesting to me. In 1946, I was at University of Toronto at a lecture by Alvar Aalto. I didn't know I was going to be interested in architecture, but I sure was moved by him.
What particularly?
As I recall, you said in what we say in the book, telling that story, you kind of wandered into the lecture. You didn't even know who Aalto was, right?
No, I didn't know who he was even after. I mean, I didn't. I only figured out when I became an architect that that's who that was, and I actually went to his office and looked in their records, and it was him. So. But then growing up in architecture in Southern California was the time of building tract houses. So there was 2x4s for miles, and there was a lot of it. And that was the easy way to build. And you could get the lumber at the yard, you could build stuff easily. And my teachers were all returning from Japan. They were all GIs who came back from Japan. They'd seen the Issei Shrine and Shosoin, all those places. So they were doing quasi-Japanese riffs with 2x4s. And it was very compelling, and it was, we were doing tract house type size buildings. I was working for some of those teachers, and I learned to, you know, nail it together and work at it. And you can see a lot of those houses, Harwell Hamilton Harris and Gordon Drake, and a lot of them. And the Green and Green brothers, and Frank Lloyd Wright. So there was an Asia centricity to becoming an architect in California.
And I think you really admired the work of Rudolf Schindler.
And Schindler.
Yeah.
And I got to know Schindler personally, so that would made it even better. But I avoided Frank Lloyd Wright. I had three opportunities to meet him. I didn't like his politics, I thought, and so I didn't go. And now I'm so sorry I didn't. I actually have like this amazing high regard for that guy, but I blew it.
Yeah, my recollection again from the book was one of them was when you were driving cross country with your wife and young daughters and stopped at Taliesin in Arizona. And were offended that they charged an admission for a tour
$1.
That they wanted to charge for the babies as well. And you said, that's ridiculous. I'm not doing that.
And I turned around and left.
Right.
And, you know, it was different. This building is done by my son, Sam, all by him. It's a children's institute in Watts for children that are beat up by their parents, and it's a counseling center.
Mm-hmm. That's a project now under construction?
Just about to be in construction.
Mm-hmm. Let's go back to Toronto. Let's stay in, because Lisa opened up something important we
let's
should talk about.
Stay in Toronto, because we're here.
Well. Yeah, no, no,
in
I know.
Fact, maybe I'll stay here permanently.
Why not?
All right.
Mm-hmm.
If anybody has a...
I know that guy, Trump. I've met him.
Right. So if anybody has a 40,000 square foot space.
Wood is obviously incredibly celebrated here at the AGO. We were just walking into the Galleria Italia. It is one of the most spectacular, breathtaking living rooms, I think, in this country.
Yes.
And I think, frankly, it outshines the new MoMA in terms of its ability to create a human space that breathes life into us. And tell us a little bit about how you came to thinking about wood and its connection to the transformation of the AGO.
I guess, I can't remember. I mean, that's the problem being 87. You can't remember anything. I don't even know why I'm here.
All right, let me help you out here a little bit. With the AGO, you were starting with, I think there are a couple of things actually that are important to say about the AGO. One of them, again, I remember because there's a lot of Toronto in this book. This book is really, could be subtitled Toronto to Los Angeles, but there's a huge amount of Toronto in it, and the story of how your mother took you to the AGO, it was then called the
Art Gallery, right.
And it was your first experience with a museum anywhere in the world, was this institution.
Walker Court.
Yeah. Right. And but when you were invited back many, many, many years later as an established architect to work on it, what you saw was a kind of mishmash of different buildings and different wings and different styles that were in need of, were crying out for some kind of coherence and overall thing. And you couldn't tear it down and start all over again. So you had a whole bunch of givens that I think even the greatest partisans of this institution would agree were not perfect. And so I think some of it came from just...
I pulled it back to my memory of Walker Court and said, why don't we enter on that as the centerpiece, because and let the project grow out of that logically instead of coming in on the end the way it was, which was confusing. Every time I came, I couldn't figure out where I was.
And
I think that was the basic realignment back to the history of the original building and then growing out from that, which makes it kind of legible, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And the beautiful, gorgeous serpentine staircase clad in wood, I mean, really became that signature piece, that organic piece that allows people, you know, to walk from the center, from the front entrance, through the undulating ramp, and to see Walker Court on access and take the staircase up into the contemporary collections.
But I had a lot of fun with Ken, because Ken wanted his ship collection. And there was a lot of anti-ship collection because did a ship collection belong in a museum? And so there was a lot of discussion about that. And I remember as a child going to the Rum. Rum, is that the other one?
Rum, yeah.
And seeing the mummies, the Egyptian mummies. And so I used to go with kids, and we would always go back because those were there. And then, by the way, we saw the rest of the art. And that was what got me into it. So I said to Ken, if we're going to do the ship collection, we got to do it in a specific way so that kids are drawn to it, but then there has to be art associated with it, which we, I think we did. I don't know if the art piece is still there. I haven't been in.
Well, I think you accomplished not only the reorganization of the AGO, but I think the wood really gave it a very distinct quality. You know, that again, your lifelong battle against the generic.
This is the equivalent of First Nation. This is Hoopa Indian Reservation in Northern California, and I'm doing an arts education program with them.
That is not art. This picture is not arts education. This is.
So that's when the.
Another part of your Canadian heritage.
When the World Cup was held here, Kenny Dryden got me to come out on the ice with all those guys.
Right. And actually, I think we should point out that those chairs, which you did for Noel, are named
cross check.
There's the cross check chair and the hat trick chair.
So Gretzky sent me a signed hockey stick. He didn't know me, but for some reason he did. And I sent him two of those chairs signed, and he gave them to his secretary or assistant.
That was generous.
That was. I think it was crazy. Those, I'm not sure in the end that those chairs might not be worth more than the hockey stick. So it's so it was may not have been wise on his part, actually.
I wonder if we might talk a little bit about the Eisenhower Monument. The Eisenhower Memorial. You've been working on it for many years, Frank. You served in the military in 1955, and that was difficult time. You ended up not only doing some signage, but I think some furniture and even some architecture for the military at the time. I think you served in the unit that Eisenhower once commanded.
I was in the 3rd Infantry, 3rd Infantry Division, 3rd Army, which was his unit when he was in.
Right.
But when I was there, he was president already.
Yeah, so.
Right.
And
we know you're younger than Eisenhower, Frank. Don't worry.
No, it's an interesting story because at that time, you know, I was politically involved from day one and everything, but he was considered the golf playing president. He was never around. We all thought he was doing nothing. And of course, we knew that finally that it was more than that. But when the competition came up And the guys in the office wanted to do it in Washington, D.C., and I was worried about getting involved with Washington, D.C. bureaucracy, and I was against it. They prevailed and convinced me we should do it. I read Ambrose, the biography, of Ike, and then for the first time realized what he really accomplished. Then I read several of the other, I got really into it and literally fell in love with the topic of Ike. And the site they gave us was on Independence Avenue in front of the Department of Education. And it was Traffic Street. It was the back side of the Aerospace Museum. It wasn't on the mall or anything. And so all of the, there were four or five finalists, and all of us made some gesture to help create the space. And my gesture was to do a tapestry in stainless steel so that it could be outdoors and last for 100 years and could be in front of the Department of Education without blocking their view. And so that's what's going to be built. But the bureaucracy of Washington was horrific. And I don't know how many people here know about the American Koch brothers, right?
So hard not to now, I'm afraid.
Yeah. So there's a counterpart in architecture. There's a Dry House Fund, DREIHAUS Fund, who is only for classical architecture. And he did what financed many people against me, and even got President Obama to appoint somebody against me. And so we did a chart of this guy, and he had tentacles into all of the committees, all of the approval process. And it was weird. And so we had to fight back. So we got all the others. And
so it really isn't about the fact you won the commission. It was really then about how to engage in this political battle.
Yeah. And finally we got it approved, and then the family was against it, and the family had to be brought into the...
It's been a process of, what, 6 years or more?
Yeah.
Now, and it still isn't in construction yet.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it's been all approved now, so it's probably going ahead. And
Well, mm-hmm. I just wanted to note, and just to kind of clear up, that, you know, you're both an American and Canadian citizen, right?
Both, yeah. Yeah,
you're both. And that you received the Companion of the Order of Canada in 2003.
Voila, and I forgot to wear it.
What? And I don't have one to give you. And and so French President François Hollande offered you a place that you could go and relocate to France in the case that Donald Trump was elected. And you said you were thinking of that. And I was wondering, well, what about Canada? If you are relocating, are you serious about relocating to France,
well,
or was that just
a moment?
I
don't know whether we should get into politics here, because some of you may think Trump is okay, but I'm very worried about him, and I remember 1937 being in Canada and listening to Hitler's speeches on radio, and this resounded similar to me, and it's just frightening. California's been pretty good so far. Governor Jerry Brown is ready to take him on, I think. But
maybe if California secedes, that's the solution to all of your problems.
Well, if we could get California, Oregon, and Washington, we could connect Mexico to the Canadian border.
Right.
Yeah, The only problem with that is it kind of leaves New York adrift as an island.
Well, you guys will figure it out.
I don't know. We're having enough problems right now just with Trump Tower. But it's interesting.
I don't know. I think, I don't know whether, I don't know. I'm 87. It's kind of hard to come back. But the day after the election, I went to the office, and people were in my office were crying. And it was pretty sad. And we talked about moving. And everybody said, wherever you go, we'll go. So there's 140 people. Have you got enough B&Bs, Airbnb?
Well, you know, it's interesting that you connect it with memories of growing up in Toronto as a child, though, too, because you've also talked, in the book, we talk a lot about this, the challenges of anti-Semitism as a young child in a working-class Jewish family in Toronto, and feeling kind of very much as an outsider. Before you were an outsider in the world of architecture, you felt like just an outsider in society in some ways. And that you're almost buffeted by the winds of all of that as a kid.
Goldberg, when I was a kid. And it was only changed much later to satisfy a wife that didn't like Goldberg. But, and I tell everybody.
Right. And then you suggested I call this book Goldberger on Goldberg.
Yes. But no, it was, I remember going to restaurants that said no Jews allowed in 1930s here. So, I mean, they didn't have an African-American or African-Canadian population. They had Jews and Asians.
But. And you felt the anti-Semitic sentiment also in the military, in the States, where you thought maybe mm-hmm. you had been disallowed from finishing your training in the Air Force.
Yes.
Because you were Jewish.
Right.
Isn't that right?
Yeah, I was in Air Force ROTC. At USC, and architecture is a 5-year class, and so I was in 4 years of ROTC training, like every week, marching, wearing the uniform, doing the whole thing. And just as I was getting into the fifth year, the final year, they called me in and said they'd made a big mistake, that I had not been really accepted back at the beginning. And, you know, if I'd have been lawyer thinking, I could have sued the hell out of them, but anyway, so they did that, and the minute I graduated, I was drafted into the Army.
Right.
And you served a year and a half. You were separated from your wife and the kids, the little kids.
Yeah. So it was 21 months.
Mm-hmm.
And then I went to... I got out 3 months out early to go to school to study city planning, and that was a mistake.
Right.
You left early.
Was at Harvard.
Well, city right. planning, I was a Mr. Do-gooder. I think I still am. You know, I want to do things, you know. And so I thought doing houses for rich people, I didn't want to spend my life doing that. So I thought city planning sounded like it had some cachet or some possibility, but city planning was about economics and government and things, which I loved. I got to study economics with Otto Eckstein, who was Kennedy's Secretary of the Treasury, and I enjoyed it all, but it wasn't about architecture, so I finally just left.
And they wouldn't let you transfer, as I remember, into the architecture program.
That was Jose Luis Sert.
Right.
Who, my best friend.
You had, you know, those stories, the problems in the Army, that...
They're all in the book.
They are all in the book, it's true. And in fact, one of the reviews of the book, I was struck by somebody who said, one of the things that surprised me most reading this book was how much failure you had experienced in your life and how many setbacks, because people think when, and this person did not mean it as a negative, in fact, it was quite the opposite. He said people assume that when somebody is as successful as you are, possibly the most famous architect in the entire world and winner of every prize anyone's ever invented, and
in other words,
people forget that, in fact, you had to struggle for a lot of that stuff.
And still, I feel like I have to.
Well,
I like it.
And you like it that way.
Yeah.
Living like
you've never taken it for granted. I think. I think that's part of the story, is of not taking success for granted, and feeling, you feel confident about your work, but you feel just insecure enough to keep pushing. I think.
So I call it a healthy insecurity, and I've been fortunate to meet a lot of creative people, very well-known ones, and I talk to them about this, and everybody that I know and respect in other fields mm-hmm. has the same feeling, I think. They talk about it very similarly. And I think it's part of the territory that it's exciting,
right.
Makes it more exciting. You're searching the unknown, and it's a curiosity, which I think in my case came from my grandfather reading Talmud to me, because the Talmud is all about why. Everything in the Talmud is why. That's why those old guys sit around a table and argue about whether this guy meant this or this guy meant that, and they argue for years about the same guy.
It's all about questions.
Yeah. And
right.
And so they take their schnapps and their stuff, and that's what they do. And I think it's the same. I was born with that.
That too is Toronto, then, right? I mean, you grew up. Your grandparents' house was on Beverly, right around the corner from here.
Right, and that building across the road with the bay window is where I was bar mitzvah. What's it called now? It was Chudley House, but when I was a kid.
Yeah, at the corner of Beverly and Dundas, right?
Yeah.
Italian consulate.
That place. Who would have known?
Who would have known, exactly. Right. Frank Gehry had his bar mitzvah in the Italian consulate. Let's start telling people about that and see what rumors we can spread.
So I stood in that bay window at a table with my back to the bay window, and my grandfather was beside me, and I delivered my bar mitzvah speech right there.
But, and I think also as a teenager, like you and Ross, Rosberger, your great friend.
He died just recently.
And you and he read the Bible and found 135 inconsistencies in the Bible. Right? Always pushing, questioning, and questioning conventional thought.
Right.
The rules.
We were at Bloor Collegiate. We were in the 11th grade, and we had a physics teacher, Joe Noble. And Mr. Noble was inclined to support people who were doing what we were doing. And so we invented a perpetual motion machine, which we built. I remember digging a hole and getting some logs, and we had it working for about 2 minutes, and then it failed.
Like every other perpetual motion machine.
Then we got to the Bible, and we decided there were a lot of contradictions, so we found all of them and recorded them all. And I stayed outside of religion. Ross became a Sunday school teacher. He just passed on, but he was a quirky mathematician, taught at the University of Waterloo. His name was Ross Hansberger, and many books on math.
Right.
And so he and I were hung out. We were renegades. He was taught me about classical music. He would play Chopin's Fantasy Impromptu, which was difficult keyboard. And we talked about Chopin and got into all that. And I think that started me down the road
And music has remained incredibly important to you.
Yeah, although I'm a pure dilettante.
There's Walt Disney Concert Hall in L.A. now, which you go to all the time. And I recall you telling me it took you 2 or 3 years after it was finished to actually enjoy the music and not worry about the building.
Right.
But now you do. Now you actually really do go and pay attention to the concerts.
I don't bother about the building. It's just there.
When you've completed those kind of masterworks, or this one, I love this one so much.
In Berlin.
The DJ Bank in Berlin, and this is the horse's head, which, Leonardo da Vinci was so inspired by horses and the bone structure.
So should I tell you how that happened?
Sure.
Yeah, please.
Tell us, yeah.
So we started to get involved with the computer and as a way of making our stuff happen, of building it, of eliminating change orders and risk and all that stuff. And so one of the first things we tried was to say, well, why are we designing with models and stuff? Why can't we design right in the computer? Which this was what, 25 years ago. So I think now everybody designs in the computer. They don't even draw. I mean, Tom Main tells me he doesn't have any paper in his office to draw on. But I tried. I couldn't do it. So I was on the computer for 3.4 minutes before I ran out of the room screaming, get me out of here. And the reason is because I had this dream image, which is there, and the computer screen had an image that was a washed out version of it, and I had to hold the dream image while I was,
You had it in your mind, but you didn't want to translate it.
I've never really been attracted to designing on the computer, so our office works in 3D models and some drawings, sketches, but mostly 3D models, and then transfers it to the computer.
Well, but you make a very big distinction between the computer as a tool of design and the computer as a tool of execution, right? Because, I mean, Bilbao could not have been built without the computer.
Right.
Most of your work today could not have been built without the computer, but it's still designed in an analog way, let's say, even if it's executed in a digital way.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's that iterative process, testing, retesting, and using the model to help test ideas.
Right.
I mean, you've taken crumpled up pieces of paper from the waste basket and put tape around them, and you had a building of some sort.
No, that's a fantasy.
That's from The Simpsons.
That's The Simpsons.
Yeah, if you look at The Simpsons, I crumple up a piece of paper, throw it on the ground.
Oh.
And then I have to say, Frank Gehry, you're a genius. And it took Judy Kavner, who plays Marge,
right,
30 minutes to get me to say, Frank Gehry, you're a genius, with force, with conviction.
Right.
Anyway. So people stop me and give me a piece of crumpled paper and ask me to sign it.
Okay, got it.
I don't do that. But since that has happened, as the world goes, sometimes I do it just for fun.
Probably feels.
But it
pretty
did.
Good.
I think probably The Simpsons ultimately was. I mean, it was good for your celebrity, but it was not good for helping people understand that you really are an architect,
right,
not a sort of person who does wild and crazy things for
their
own sake.
That you just pull solutions out of a hat,
Exactly. That you actually think hard and analyze things and just then express them in your own language, maybe is the way to put it.
So Frank, what kind of work is really feeding your soul right now?
Well, this project, the LA River, the LA River is 51 miles, and it goes through 15 political jurisdictions. So they have 15 mayors, 15 councils. And LA City has 11 of the miles. And Mayor Garcetti asked me to help him. He said, New York has a thing called the High Line, which everybody loves.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he said, we have 51 miles of river. Can't you do something with it? And I said, Mayor Garcetti, the High Line is a derelict, rusting railroad bridge. And they put some plants on it. And people can walk on
it. Some very nice plants.
It's nice, you know. Yeah, Piet Oldolf did the planning and did a great job. And people walk on it. And I said the LA River is a flood control project. It has different issues. So we've been studying it for over 2.5 years now. And it has its own mandate. The long and short of it is, if we can recapture a certain amount of the water from it and use it, then LA doesn't have to buy water from outside that amount. And it's a significant amount that it would make financial sense to take this seriously and to do it. And then the river goes through some neighborhoods which are primarily Latino and African American, where the health issues are out of normalcy and disgusting and embarrassing, I think. But nobody seems to be taking that. And there's a lack of open space. So all those red things are where that happens. There's the health issues are costing the taxpayers billions of dollars. So if we could combine the recapturing the water and solve some of the open space issues and serve the converting the river into an asset for public use, that's a great outcome. So that's what we're trying to do. And it's difficult because the normal people who have been working on the river for years think of it as a place where you just use it as a habitat where the birds and the froggies and the fishies will come, and all you have to do is plant trees and it'll be beautiful. And the problem is, if you do all of that, in the course of the river, when I call it Godzilla, when Godzilla comes, which is once in a while, once a year maybe, or once every 5 years, if all those plants and stuff are there, then the river overflows, and for six houses on either side, they're underwater.
Right.
And Godzilla will wipe out all the plants and all the birdies and all the fishies and everything, including people.
Yeah.
So there's a dangerous... it's interesting because it's a public works thing that's possible, and I've been working with... we've connected with all of the mayors. We've taken the time, all of the mayors, all the city councils. And this is philanthropy. I'm not being paid, but... You asked me what I'm interested in.
And this is part of it. Yeah.
That's part of
It's very interesting, too, that
the river
underscores the fact that you're not, you know, it's not that you just run around putting weird shapes everywhere, which is, I think, what people thought when you were appointed to take over the river.
That's what they thought.
They thought, that you were going to turn it all into something that...
They keep asking me, when are you going to put the shapes?
right. Yeah, how come this isn't going to look like the front of the AGO, the entire riverfront,
right,
or what have you?
The other thing we've taken an interest in is and that woman to the left of me is Melissa Shriver from the Shriver family, and they invented philanthropy, those guys. And I hired her, and we're... In California, There are over 100 schools where the dropout rate of fifth grade elementary school is amazingly high. And the prisons for the future are planned on that population. It's the most cynical thing. So if there's over 100 schools in California, you can imagine how much in the United States. So the US education system, public school system, is really broken in a serious way. Michelle Obama started what she called turnaround schools in the East Coast, and had about 15 or 20 schools where you bring artists in, which is something I used to do years ago with my kid sister, is we'd go to ghetto schools and get kids interested in making things together, and then you'd get their interest, and then you could teach math and civics and all kinds of stuff. So we signed on to Michelle's program, and we now have 16 schools in California. Mm-hmm. And I need to raise $30 million so I can do all of them.
And you've gone to this school. This is in Northwestern California. You've gone, you've mentored
you've
kids. You've
personally involved yourself with it.
Yeah, and so yeah, we make a community. The Hoopa Indian Reservation is a hermetic reservation. The kids are, there's a lot of molestation, a lot of drugs, a lot of bad stuff happening.
Frank, you've spent your whole life being involved in social issues, and we've talked a certain amount about your upbringing in Toronto being attuned to liberal causes and sort of working class identity and being made aware of all that in Toronto. Do you resent or the implication that, or the fact that it's sometimes hard to shake off the image of a rich, fancy, globe-trotting architect? How do you deal with that image versus what you know to be the reality, which is of much more concern with a lot of other stuff that you do?
Well, I don't think I'm thought that way, but maybe I am.
Some people think of you that way. I mean, I don't, but Lisa doesn't, but
well,
some people do.
Since I turned 82 or 5, I think, I charter planes for trips, not across the ocean, but because traveling is what knocks me out, so I can get more done. And I think people think I'm, because I have a charter every once in a while, that I'm super rich. I just use up my whatever profits we make on to, so that I can keep doing it. But I don't feel like that.
No, I know you don't. I mean, but do you resent the
Well, I don't. Yeah. I the thing I resent is when people don't believe me that Bilbao costs $300 a square foot.
Right.
And that it doesn't cost more to make architecture, because at that time museums were being like $500 a square foot. And so, and with that, and you can always do it. So you can make architecture with the same budget as they can make crappy buildings. So I can prove that.
So, okay.
So then why do you choose to make crappy building? I don't know.
Well,
and we let it happen. And so that's why, if anybody saw the image of me giving the finger to the reporter in Spain, I was tired. The guy said, "What do you say to people who think your buildings are showy?" And I was like, I was Dr. Strangelove. But reporters don't say, I said to him later, I said, why don't you ask that of the other 98% of the people who do the normal buildings, who build all the cities around the world? You know, when somebody's honestly trying to do something, you may like it or don't like it, that's fine, but to try and put it into some kind of demeaning category is not fair. It's not.
And I think architects, you know, increasingly have ceded so much territory.
Yes.
And perhaps more and more territory being picked up by public artists, you know, that we turn to public art, like the great public artists like Olafur Eliasson or Anish Kapoor or, you know, James Turrell, and those are the places we go, even temporary installations like Nuit Blanche to kind of...
Well, as an antidote almost, yes, yes.
To feel alive again, because so often our cities are places of sameness and they sort of like, of course, can have a great level of competent architecture, but as places to go for right. soul-giving architecture...
But here we're seeing on the screen right at this moment a sort of analysis of that building in New York, 8 Spruce Street, in which technology allowed you to build an unusual, one-of-a-kind building for essentially the price of a much more conventional building.
Because we eliminated change orders.
Mm-hmm.
So that curtain wall was built with zero change orders, which is a big part of it. So if you take that right. 15% you normally pay for change orders into the quality of the building,
right.
it's the same price.
Many of the moves here or the lessons, I believe, would be brought to the Mervish project,
yeah.
the skyscrapers that you're presenting.
The Mervish project is really a descendant of this building,
right.
Even bigger and, I think, more adventurous in many ways for Toronto.
Yeah, but, you know, Mervish is a unique client, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's not an ordinary...
fellow.
No.
Right.
He's not a conventional development company.
He's an artist in his own right,
right
about what he does.
With an amazing collection of right. modern art.
Right.
Color fields. How is that going? Just update us so we have the latest. The Mervish...
I'm not allowed to talk yet, but
well, it has city council approval.
Well, but right. I think there were some versions of it that were in our rotating loop a little while ago, so it appeared.
I'm hopeful, and it looks promising that sooner or later we're going to build it.
Yeah.
And I plan to live long enough to do that.
Have a unit, yeah.
So
nice.
I should just say for the public. The intent was that when I started working on it, that Toronto has buildings built, like the City Hall, which you all like and we all like, it's a nice architect enough. But that architect didn't pay any attention to Toronto. It was that architect putting a thing there.
Villiers-Ravel's City Hall, yeah.
And you like it and I like it, but I was one, and then a lot of buildings are being built, and they don't say anything. And I talked to David about it. I said, you know, in New York, they built Rockefeller Center. And Rockefeller Center's, I'm not saying we should copy the past, but if you think about the new complex, thinking about Union Station, the Royal York Hotel, the Osgoode Hall, the all the buildings I remember from my childhood, and think about the aesthetic of that and try to talk to it with a new building. Mm-hmm. That might be an interesting change of events here, that this could become something special. So that's what we're trying
to do. Which is very much what you did in New York, actually, with right. the Woolworth Building, which is a couple blocks away, and which it
right.
does engage in a dialogue with.
Right. So I was very respectful of the Woolworth Building. I was very respectful of the Brooklyn Bridge. And I made a building that talked to
right,
those entities.
Right.
And when you look at the picture, which you saw earlier, but it does work.
Right, yeah, yeah. Very, very much.
And so that's something I've been interested in. But,
right. I was intrigued to learn that in Algonquin, the meaning of Lake Temiskaming means deep waters. And during one of your summers in New Liskeard, your mother met with a handwriting analyst who, I guess, read your handwriting. And
I was 11 years old.
Predicted you would be a famous architect.
Right, right. That is true.
And
I didn't know what an architect was when she did.
Well, you were 11. And you have received, as Stefan, you know, indicated, you've received the highest honors for your work. Major retrospectives at the Guggenheim and the Centre Pompidou.
Sydney, in Toronto, yeah.
It's coming. Let's get it to come to Toronto.
Okay. Actually, that would be a perfect thing to put in the Great Hall right here.
Yeah.
Can you imagine the gallery? Yeah. Can you imagine that filled with Gehry models, actually?
Yeah.
Would be spectacular.
Yeah. I like it.
I think.
And I remember watching with you the Sidney Pollack film Out of Africa, the great director made about you. And, you know, your Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao, Spain, which has actually created, remarkably, but also kind of simplistically, the Bilbao effect.
Right.
You told me that, I mean, I think you were about 70 years old when that opened, and you were worried about the public response to it. You were concerned the day before it opened about what
people
would think.
Boy, you remember everything, Lisa. I better be careful what I tell you.
Well, that story is also in the book, though, where you said you went to the site the night before the public opening.
Oh, and
I think it's a wonderful story because it says so much about you, because you're in, even though it had already been acclaimed by a lot of people, it wasn't officially open and finished, and your first thought was, oh my God, what have I done to these people? so you were still...
A little bit nervous
about the building.
That? What were you thinking?
Right.
I thought it was over the top and, you know, all that kind of stuff. But I could live in Bilbao for free for the rest of my life.
That's nice. Well,
has Toronto offered that yet?
I mean, I put it out there.
Put your hand up if you have a spare bedroom for Frank Gehry.
Right.
But yeah. I wanted to just say this idea of the creeping sense that you might have failed. If you go back in time through your own deep waters, what advice would you give to your younger self?
Oh boy, I did that. You can have that on tape. You can buy it.
He did that for CBS. It's true.
Oh, really? Charlie Rosa?
Yeah.
On tape, I talked to myself.
Oh, what did you say?
I forget, but I think I said something, no matter what, just keep your eye on what you're interested in and continue to work toward that. Be yourself. Never try to match anybody else because you'll fail. Things like that.
Yeah.
Questions.
Yeah. You know, it's one of the things we got into in this book was all of that stuff. And I think I should add to this conversation how remarkable it was that you wanted to embark on a biography that was not a personal memoir or not an authorized biography in the sense of controlling it. Because when we first started talking about it and your desire to have a book that would trace and track the whole story of your life, which has been a life with a fair amount of drama and ups and downs, as we've said, not a straight line of success in any way, and has had, you know, extraordinary events and adventures and drama of many, many kinds, I said I'd be willing to do it, but only if you agree that you have no control over it and I can write what I said. And I think there are very few people who would do it on those terms. And that's something I want to publicly thank you for, because it's rare that anybody would do that.
So, back before that happened, I was being asked by several people about doing a biography And it was, that was getting claustrophobic, and I got scared that somebody was going to do something. And so I knew Paul, but I was afraid to talk to anybody. And so I had an agent friend, and I talked to him, and he said, well, wouldn't you think of Paul? And I said, God, that would be great, because, and then somehow we got together on it. I mean, it was a trust, because I've known him, but I think he has the knowledge of me from the beginning almost, and I knew that.
Well, I wasn't there at the bar mitzvah. I mean, that's not. but for quite a long.
I have a picture of you there in a tallis. You look like the guy.
That's it. Right.
I remember having a schnapps with you.
That's it. That's it.
Across the road. Anyway. It started out as a protective gesture because I was afraid of what was going to happen, and I thought I'd rather have a preemptive.
Right, preemptive strike.
Strike, and then it worked out that he was willing to do it. And of course he made that condition, which I was probably wouldn't have accepted with anybody else, but
well, thank you.
With him I would.
Thank you. Thank you. And it's a Yeah.
Frank, any last words as we are drawing, I believe the session is drawing to
a close. I still have a Canadian thing in me, okay? So.
Yeah.
Well, I think this has in part been a tale of talking about the 75 years from across the street to your bar mitzvah to this room here at AGO and all the extraordinary things that have happened in the 75 years it took to get from one side of that street to the other.
I don't feel as old as I am. So
I think if you don't feel as old as you are, then you are healthy and great and good things will come.
And we'll see you again very soon in Toronto.
Absolutely. Yes,
thank you.
Thank you.
I've had the pleasure, Mr. Gehry, of seeing at least 7 of your buildings and photographing them. And one interesting thing is when I was photographing here at the AGO, and I don't know if you're aware of it, but the serpentine stairs you're talking about in the center of the gallery, one day I took an adventurous act and I lied on my back and I shot up them. And lo and behold, there's a G that's formed in the decoration of the serpentine stairs. So I call it G for Gehry. And it's amazing what you see when you look at things in a different perspective of your work. And I really, really appreciate that.
So I've always been told by my teachers that if something happens accidentally, take credit for it.
Thank you very much for this engaging and candid talk. I was curious, what are some of the most important lessons that you've learned in your extraordinary career? And what is the advice that you would have for the city of Toronto regarding its architectural landscape?
The question was a very simple question. What lessons do you have from your career, and what advice do you have for the city of Toronto in terms of improving its architecture? You can answer that in one sentence, I'm sure.
Really?
Well, try the second part. Let's just start with Toronto. What should Toronto do other than build the Mirvish building to improve its architecture?
Well, just demand better architecture. Knowing that it doesn't cost more, so. You know, try it. You might like it.
You know, I want to interject a little question that relates to that. Do you think it's better to try and fail or not to try at all? In other words, there are a couple of ambitions. We don't need to mention certain other museums, but let's say there's a couple of other attempts in Toronto that are very ambitious that some people feel are not wholly successful. Do you feel that it's better to do that or to not try? Okay. You don't want to answer that one, huh?
Well, it depends who's trying and what their intent is. If it's some kind of an ego trip, then, you know, I don't think I would support it. But if it has an honesty of intent and working for the community, for the topic, for the... yeah, I think there's more talent around that can do stuff that doesn't get a chance to.
Right.
And maybe it's worth, you know, supporting some of that. And I think the museum can be a catalyst for finding those people by having these kind of discussions, lectures, show their work, if you took the younger 30 to 35 year old, say, architects coming out of the University of Toronto and having small shows of their work, so you can see the beginnings of ideas and things. And if you got people like Lisa around that are going to weigh in and over time, I think I we did that in LA. It was really interesting what happened when I was already starting to be known, but there was a architecture critic, Dreyfus.
John Dreyfus in 1979. Yeah, yeah.
So John Dreyfus became the critic of the LA Times, architecture critic. And he wasn't an architect. He didn't really know in depth what he was doing, but he had a good heart. And so he found all the people that were doing interesting things. Right. And every week he would publish a thing right. on them. So Tom Main was one of them, and a lot of others. And out of that grew a group of, you became yeah. familiar with, and those people got work, for better right. or for worse. But it was it's sort of, you know, it's called watering your garden.
Yeah, and the whole architecture culture began to grow up in Los Angeles around that. Around That's that. True. Yeah.
And this guy didn't. Yeah. Really, yeah. He wasn't really an architecture guy.
Right.
And
right.
It's also the responsibility of media, for sure, but also the institutions, your potential clients.
Yeah.
And also to try to check in and question some of the protocols. For instance, certain school boards will only hire architects who've already built 10 schools. So it gives right. it eliminates all of the bright...
And fresh ideas.
Fresh ideas, the right. authentic, the honest, right. You know... who have so much to contribute and such
right.
energy to contribute, they get tossed to the side and others get privileged.
Absolutely right.
Right.
Do we have time for one or two more?
Yeah.
One more, okay.
I wanted to ask about designing Disney Hall, because I love Disney Hall, and specifically about designing for music. There are many cases of halls coming to grief because the architects and acousticians were at odds. And also, once the acoustical issues are dealt with, the fact that music is an auditory experience, how do you create an environment visually that enhances that?
You could talk about Boulez, actually, if you want. Boulez Hall. I said, if you want to bring in the Berlin Hall.
So we're doing a little hall in Berlin as a gift, actually, for the Divan Orchestra. That's Daniel Berenbaum and Edward Said started it, and it has Palestinians, Israelis, Syrians, whatever. I attended the auditions a few weeks ago in Berlin, and I was crying all through it. There was Israeli boy, a Syrian girl, an Egyptian cello, blah, blah, blah. And they started playing music together, and you know, there it was. But why did that have anything to do with his question?
About because you're doing a hall for them.
Yes. So I think that The acoustician is important, right? And so you can go to halls where there is a good acoustician, but you have to close your eyes because the architecture isn't conducive. But a room that encourages interrelationship of people, which this room is difficult for that, right? It's a little bit, I mean, I can, the nice thing is the lights are on, I can see you, but it would be nice if we could cuddle a little bit. And so there is a way to make spaces that create a relationship between people, and in a concert hall, a relationship between the orchestra and the audience. And that's crucial. And the orchestra, like I feel the difference, the orchestra can feel the relationship to the audience. And they play better, right? And the audience is happier, and that feeling is conveyed, so it's a plus, it grows. And people like to come there. So Disney Hall is filled every night, and it's one of the few orchestras in the United States that's not on relief. they're paying their own way. And so it has to do with the architecture of the music. I mean, it's not just the architecture. It's not just the acoustician. But the acoustician that I work with are from Japan. And since we've been working together, they realize that they say at least 30 to 35% is psychoacoustic, they call what I do, psychoacoustic. So, and they understand it, and I think people relate to it. And they've done halls that are acoustically perfect, where the psycho part isn't well done, and they know the difference, and they don't, you know, they. So, there is this connection, and again, it has to do with the quality of the architecture, the respect for humanity, and the respect for the way people are seated, the way they're related to the room, to the orchestra, to the feelings, to the blah, 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 blah.
Okay. I think we have time for one more question. There's someone in the middle.
We stayed in your hotel in El Ciego this summer, and it was fabulous. But I'm curious, they told us it started out as an office building and that it was converted to a hotel in the winery. And I wondered what kind of a challenge that was for you. The Marquess de Mariscal.
It wasn't an office building, it was a building from scratch.
Oh, they told us that it had originally been intended to be an office building, and I wondered how you'd made that transition. So they gave us wrong information?
No, their winery was partly an office building, which I didn't do. I did the hotel from scratch, and on that site was their family home, which they demolished and built that on.
Well, that hotel is situated truly one of the most spectacular things.
Yeah, so I would like to do more hotels if there are any hotel clients in the audience.
Right, you heard it here first. Okay, I think we're at time. I know that many people have questions. I would encourage you to check out Paul's book at the back of the room that he'll be signing. But I wanted to thank again Paul and Lisa and Frank Gehry for coming here today and sharing your thoughts with us. It's truly remarkable.